Hello, Malty Maltodextrans. I'm Ralphy, and this is Ralphy Review 645. Now, with the cork in one hand and a bottle of whiskey in the other, we are ready to commence. This is a blended scotch. A blended scotch is a combination of single malt, one or more, and grain whiskies, one or more. Single malt coming from a pot still, the grain whiskies coming more often than not, but not always, from column stills. And this particular version is Dewars 18-year-old, what does it say again? Double-aged, right? I'll explain this double-aged thing to you shortly. So here we have an 18-year-old age statement, traditional blended scotch, 40% volume. It's the strength, and it's generally quite widely available. And in fact, you should see it in the more upmarket bars, in bigger hotels. This is a sort of more sophisticated, more expensive blend that you'll come across. And I've bought this, and I'm reviewing this simply so as to feature an older blend, so as that you've got the comparison, a review of this, and compare it to the majority of reviews I do, Malt Mates, which is about single malt Scotch whisky, amongst other spirits. But I do notice in the UK, in the British Isles, that the price of aged blends is really now on a par with a lot of single malts. So I do not plan to do any more blend reviews for quite a long time now, because there's it used to be that you could get an aged blend quite significantly cheaper than an aged single malt, depending on where you bought it. But that's really not the case now. It's interesting in that the supermarkets, particularly at seasonal times of year when people are buying whiskey, so just before Christmas, New Year, or St. Andrew's Night, you will notice that in fact it's the single malts that tend to have the special offers now, not the blends. Anyway, Dewars. In the last review, 644, it was Johnny Walker Platinum, 18-year-old, another 18-year-old. And what was interesting, one of the interesting aspects about that blend is that you could pick out really the presence and characteristics of a few malts. But in fact, in the Johnny Walker range, an awful lot of different whiskies are involved. And they maybe feature prominently in certain single malts, like Kleinlish, like Mortlach, like Craigenmore or Dalwhinnie. But generally, that they're swappable, they're interchangeable. So when you've got a complex blend with a big long recipe list, you're less likely to pick out prominent individual characteristics. Because, of course, the purpose of blending is to blend, to remove the prominent features of specific malts and make them, rather than be a solo, make them part of a band, so to speak. But here with the Dewars, there's fewer malts involved. One of them, of course, Aberfeldy, which I don't rate particularly highly, but it's a decent enough malt on a good day. And not that I'll be buying any for a while, but there's, in the Dewars range, there's simply fewer malts involved. And you notice that. You also notice that this isn't a blend that's trying to be everything. It's not trying to be a bit of Islay, a bit of Highland, a bit of Lowland, and a bit of Speyside. There's very little peat about it. It's virtually unpeated. There is a little bit in the background. Brings a little crispness. And a little bit of substance, bit spicy notes, a little bit of toffiness in the background. A little tiny touch of smoke. But it really is quite distant, and to be honest, it could be coming from the casks. And the trick is that rather than peat a whisky, you mature it in peated whiskey casks. So if you want, for example, your Auchentoshan to be a little bit peaty, you don't actually have to use peated malted barley. No, you can mature that Auchentoshan in a cask which previously matured Laphroaig. So you're going to get a little bit of peat influence. Pulteney did that quite successfully. Anyway, back to Dewars 18-year-old. That's what you're here for. You really want to know, by the way, what's this double-aged thing? What's going on there? I'll come to that shortly. Toffee. Fudgy, slightly. Nice, clean citrus note. Honeyed. Honeyed citrus. Citrus isn't separate. It's not too, you know, lemon juice, grapefruit juice. There's more of a kind of lemon citrus going on, which is blending in with a little bit of butterscotch and a slight nuttiness in the nose. What you really find in first contact is that for 40% volume, actually the nose is quite bold. It's quite assertive. It smells more like a 43% whiskey than a 40% whiskey. It is 40% in it. Yes, it is. I had myself doubting for a minute there. Nose is more like a 43% whiskey. And I also notice immediately that the freshness of the grain whiskey in the background is really quite discreet. It's not encroaching. You can see that this whiskey's well meshed together, it's well married, and there's a reason for that, specific reason, which I'll be coming to shortly. And there's a slight sherryish note, but it's not trying to be bold or assertive or definitive. It's subtle, it's in the background, it's kind of interlaced with the rest of the event. So what you have when you smell this is not something which is kind of oaky and smelling of age, but it certainly smells of some discreet, comprehensive maturation of some lighter Highland and Speyside whiskies with a clean, fresh grain. And it is a good quality grain content to this. Taste-wise, the arrival, and just a few drops in this, by the way, the arrival is quite assertive. So you get a real kind of surge of youthfulness on the palate, but it very quickly settles down. And it really is a sort of fresher, slightly more aggressive version on the palate of what you're getting on the nose. Again, in the palate initially, you're really not sensing 18 years of maturation going on in this bottle. But that will come in time, because you need time with this, just like you do with single malts. The arrival. Quite sharp, but toffeed, rich, and spicy cola, cream soda, ginger. That's how I would define it. I do notice a little bit of touch of peatiness, but it's right in the background. You really don't notice it until the development's well underway and you're looking and going into the finish. The finish is nice and crisp and clean and fresh, and it really coats the mouth quite well in the aftertaste. And what you have is a little bit of ginger, some fresh brewed light English tea. So it's not breakfast tea. It's not your tea bag tea. This is your quality tea leaf in the teapot, in the heated teapot type English tea. Earl Grey, little bit of that, but not quite as scented. Darjeeling, fair dues, you could say that. There's that little aromatic tea note. And I'm also noticing that this hasn't, although it's chill filtered, although it has, by the looks of it, caramel in it, they're really not influencing it too negatively at all. So there's been a quite mature and sympathetic preparation of this whiskey prior to it being bottled in terms of filtration and additional colourant. It really is worth giving this whiskey time in the glass. Forget the ice, forget the mixers. This is very much a blend that you can enjoy straight. And you feel you're getting a little bit of lowland highland going on with a little bit of spicy, slightly Glenfarclas-y thing. Something, a little hint of sherried medicinal notes in the background. The development comes a little bit longer, a little bit more subtle. So when this whiskey settles down, it becomes more subtle. It's not in your face. It's not bold and assertive. It's understated. It's discreet. It's but it certainly 18 years is reflected in terms of smell and taste. That really does come across, but not as an asserted oakiness, leather and polish and such things that you would associate with older age, but it's more a rounding off of existing flavours, a complicating of the simple contributory flavours when this was starting to mature. And so it really comes across as quite a traditional maturation. Gentle, slow, understated. It's not trying to be a one-point hit. Do you know what I mean by that? It's not trying to say, look at the smokiness, ignore the rest of me, just look at the smokiness, bang, there we are, that's the event. Or look at the sweetness, ignore the rest of the flavour, just look at the sweetness of the content, bang, there you go. This is something, I've got a little bit sweet, a little bit sour, a little bit cereal, a little bit toffee. So he's got a little bit of a lot of things all adding up and nicely balanced together. And that's what really makes this blend. A wee lemony note, nice sharp tangy note creeping in now as it develops in the glass. So another thing about an older blend, like a malt, if it's of quality, it will develop and progress over time and change its nature and character in the glass. Here we are, 86 out of 100 malt mates. It's a blend mark from Ralfy here in the Manx Bothy. Yeah, there we go. Now, I think it's worth pointing out, because I'm pretty sure I forgot to mention. I did. That malt moment, maltodextrins, were supplied by John Richard. Rickard. Thank you, John Rickard, for your malt mention. It's been mentioned. And fortunately, because I've remembered after I've forgotten, I've not embarrassed myself. Wonderful. Moving on. Double-aged, double-matured, additional matured, distiller's edition. There's an awful lot of different terminology out there, which is really an appliance of marketing terminology and doesn't have specific meaning as such. However, when you come across a little phrase on a bottle and you're interested and curious, for example, it says here on the label, double aged, and it shows two casks, it says double aged, which makes you think, righto, if it's double aged and it's got two casks, it's two separate casks, probably one's a bourbon cask, one's a hogshead, so you've got a combination of bourbon matured and sherry matured whiskies. But no, I've been to the official site just to check it out. And in fact, what's happened here is something that's quite traditional with blends, particularly in the old days. With many modern young blends, they don't bother doing this. But in fact, what's happened here is that Dewars have blended their contributory malts and grains in separate casks. And then a few weeks or months prior to bottling a batch of their whiskey, what they've done is they have poured and blended their batch into a stainless steel cask, vat. After which, instead of letting it sit before they bottle it, they have then taken their pre-blended whiskey, both the single malts and the blends, all in the correct proportion according to the specifications of the blender. And then they have put the liquor back in to oak casks. Now, what this means is that you no longer have the separate malt and grain ingredients, contributory malts, basically coming from separate casks and then being brought together and then just bottled, which gives you a slightly disjointed, unmarried, unconsolidated experience. What they've done is they've put the post-blend back into casks and give it another period, mixed together in a number of casks to settle down and marry, and importantly to carry on maturing. So in fact you have the grain whiskey and the number of malts involved all together in one casks, and not only are they marrying together and consolidating their flavour for a better delivery of the result, but there's an ongoing maturation continuity. Now, it's not for a very long time, malt mates. It can only be maybe for even sometimes a couple of days. It could be a couple of weeks, a couple of months. But it all adds up to a better finished result. And there's a number of blends do this that never mention it. And I really think it would be very useful marketing to do so, because we're now in the age where an awful lot more people than in the old days, the good old, bad old days, actually take an interest, a real interest, in what they're actually drinking. And there you have it. That's what this double-aged means. Sometimes it's a bit of a challenge, actually, because we tend to get desensitized to marketing because it's so similar most of the time. Because all spirits, it's really a very conservative industry. There really isn't much scope and room for being inventive and pioneering in any spirits industry out there, any at all. It is notoriously conservative. That's just the way it is. It's part of the character of the scene. But it's interesting that in even a few years ago, nobody would have given a second glance to the information on the label of a bottle. So long as they saw it was whiskey, it was brown, and it had a brand that they recognised, they would go with it. But times have changed. So it's probably worth bottlers, producers, reviewing and updating and adding additional information to their whiskey, whether it be blend or malts, to enhance the integrity of the product, because integrity connected to quality spirits at this moment in time, malt mates, as you and I know, sells the stuff very effectively. I'm Ralfy, thank you for watching. Haste you back again for Ralfy Review 646, in which I'll be reviewing a single malt, beginning with the letter D and ending with Ston. That was a bit of a giveaway, wasn't it? Bye-bye.